sure we can salvage it and it'll be whatever.
Yeah. All right, we're recording now. All right. Okay. This lags, just a reminder to myself, just fix it later on. Doesn't really matter. I'm not going to upload this tomorrow. All right, 3, 2, 1. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another exciting episode of the Hollywood Uncensored Podcast. Rossi, I'm a changed man, brother. I am a changed man. It has been a long road and journey to get to a little movie, a little fanfic, if I might.
A little long movie.
A small budget cinema movie that came out this last Thursday on HBO Max. Ladies and gentlemen, the Snyder Cut is real and it is fabulous. Ladies and gentlemen, let's throw it to Rossi Montgomery. Welcome back to the podcast, brother. Let me get your early thoughts on the highly anticipated Snyder Cut.
Well, always always happy to be here. And thanks for having me once again. Mm-hmm. It has been quite a bit of time. And I feel like before we even started getting into recording again and whatnot, we've been talking about the cut that may not exist. And then it did exist. And now it exists even more. We've seen it. We've witnessed it. It is real. I can't really think of like a quick way to, my hat goes literally off to Zack Snyder right off the bat. Regardless of our opinions and anybody else's out there, to literally have the balls to say kind of fuck you, I'm doing my movie, I'm doing my script, my vision, my idea, my dream, whatever, that takes a lot. And you cannot, right off the bat, again, solely opinionated, you cannot watch the Snyder Cut and the original theatrical cut and not tell the difference. You know what I mean? Like, they are night and day, no pun intended,
2 minutes
completely different. Yeah. Yes. The opening credits are completely different. Immediately. And yeah, that was my first thought too about like watching it. I just instinctively was like, oh shit, this is a different movie. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's see where we go. So I think right off the bat, you know, that was the big thing. Obviously, those that have seen the theatrical and maybe rewatched it recently before the Snyder Cut came out, you definitely see similarities. You definitely see certain parts that are still in it. But I feel like every time there was a scene where I'm like, oh, I remember this from the other one, within like a minute or two, it just builds so much more. And then I'm like, okay, now I see the additional. Yeah. Now I see the other version. And I feel like that was really interesting because as a fan of the comics, as a fan of these movies and everything, as much as at times, you know, we personally want these ones to fail sometimes because of not liking the directors, not liking the actors, whatever. Mm-hmm. It was really good just to see, not just for the superhero aspect, but the fact that a comic book movie really, I personally feel, did a great job of, you have these 4 hours
being so a comic
immediately book. You have that. Yeah. And then within 4 hours, you really did see a lot of not just origin stories, I would say, but you got a lot of character depth and growth from each and every character. Yep. That was not in the theatrical version at all.
It was rushed. It was completely
rushed. It was very, very rushed. And I think that's a huge point for Snyder Cut, that you have a team. You have 6 different people, but in each time when it's their time to shine on the screen, they took the time to just give you little kind of subtle things, little kind of dialogue, little backstories, everything. I just feel like, wow, it, as I was watching it, just kind of thought like, oh shit, man, like this, it had me interested as well. It was definitely one of those. There really wasn't a moment where I was like, oh, I'm tuning out now, or I'm bored.
Oh yeah, no. It just, the pacing of it was so, the funny thing about that's like, the pacing of a 4-hour movie was somehow better than the 2-hour 30 minutes we got with Josh Whedon's cut. Like, it matters sometimes. So the people that complain about long movies, you're either going to get the full story or you're going to get a very short, congested story that doesn't make a sense because you don't really understand all the values that are happening with, especially in Justice League. You got to remember, like, there was already 2 other movies before it, and that was one director's vision, and this was technically, I guess you could say, the third part of a trilogy. that didn't have that said director. And kind of Star Wars went through the same thing when they had J.J., Rian Johnson, J.J.
Okay, that's true. Yeah.
And there was that miscommunication where it's like, okay, wait, you built one thing, you went a totally different direction the other thing, and then you try to fix it the last way. It just, it's funny to me how like 4 hours fucking made more sense than the 2 hours we got in the theaters.
Oh, yeah. I think that, and that's a funny point that you just made me think of it. I always try to tie in anything to either personal experiences or life or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's definitely the thought of taking someone else's work and either having to make sense of it or to make it work is very difficult. I can vouch for that on the music side. Mm-hmm. I've been given lyrics from people. I've been given music from people, this and that. It's not the same of writing it yourself. It's very, very different. And it's absolutely very, very difficult to not only get it done, but to feel like you did a good job or that it was an accomplishment. I'm not trying to join the bandwagon right now of fuck Whedon, but it's kind of hard. But yeah, it's one of those things though, for his film that you see how much was changed. And again, not to kind of just dig to him, but if it made sense to change it, great. Awesome. The way this movie seemed, I don't think anything made not make it any better. Like yet, nothing was changed for the good, I honestly feel.
Yeah.
It was very just, now looking back at theatrical cut, it's very all over the place. Very rushed, like you said too. Mm-hmm. But it's hard to get into that.
Yeah, the problem I have mostly with the theatrical cut was just that, like, just look at the beginning of the movie, dude. The movie starts with the CGI Henry Cavill,
sweet mustache,
and they had a kid videotaping him with a cell phone camera, and that's how they wanted you to remember Superman. But that's like, you could tell that the complete pacing of both movies are just insanely different from both spectrums. Like, it's insane to me how 4 hours and 2 minutes, as long as that is, and I've seen people complaining about how long it is, it's so much better structured than a 2 hour and 30 minute movie. You would think a movie that has less time would be able to tell a story quicker, but somehow it was more rushed. It's kind of insane.
Yeah, I mean, it absolutely is. And I guess like the biggest thing for the 4 hour mark census of it is that you get a lot of time to make a good story.
Mm-hmm.
Now we've seen movies that are hours long that don't do that. So that's where this could have failed very, very quickly. I don't think it did that though. I felt like the story progressed. I thought it was kind of not needed, but it was a funny little nod to have like the parts, like, so you know what part you're on or what.
Yeah, very Tarantino.
Oh, yeah, very much so. And I feel like it just kind of added something to it. So that was kind of just, like, interesting of itself.
Yeah.
And just going through it, yeah, like, I don't feel like there was a moment where I was, like, necessarily lost or, like, oh, which part are we on? You know what I mean? Like, it just, if the movie progressed. Yeah. The movie flowed together really well. It progressed and it kept going to where I was like, okay, now it's building towards this. Now it's going. And that's the funnier thing too, where not only is the original one very, very rushed because you're in a 2 hour mark,
mm-hmm.
but it was very rushed to where I feel like they got together, talked for a bit, and then were like, oh shit, we got to get Superman back. Then they had that whole scene. Then they got to get, it was just so much.
It was so much. I like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This one, you had pretty much half the film was Batman getting the team together. Mm-hmm. And so you had all this part, and then that's when I'm not gonna not say it, but the biggest thing alone from the differences of the original to the Snyder cut is that Cyborg is the main character.
Yeah, easily. Yep.
You know what I mean?
He goes from being like, oh, I'm just here to say booyah. That's literally what we're building to. That's the Josh Whedon cut. It's literally, he's just there to be like, booyah, and that's it. And that was Geoff Johns more than anything being like, honestly, we only care, because Ray Fisher has talked about this on Twitter, being like, I only care about you saying the catchphrase. And the guy from Doom Patrol is so much better than you, and we're just here for this, and we're going to get this over with, and we're going to restart everything anyways. I'm really happy that Ray Fisher got his moment, because that's Cyborg, dude. The all the intangibles that you got, him having a good heart and giving that single mother money because he can control literally everything. Him feeling neglected by his father who runs Star Lab. It's like it just added a layer to that character that in the Whedon cut, you're just like, why is he here? Like, what is the point of Cyborg?
Yeah, and well, like, especially how you just said it, in the Whedon's or the Whedon cut or that version, whatever the fuck we call it for now on, I guess.
The Joss cut, the Justice League.
The shit league, I don't know, man. Like, in that one, it was just like, oh, Cyborg's a robot and he can do some things. Whereas in this, yeah, you're like, he can fucking do whatever the fuck he wants. His father literally tells him, you can go and launch every missile in the world right now if you want. Go for it. It's just, it was so much so much crazier to see how much more his story grew from it. Compared to, like you said, just fucking saying a word or being there to be there.
Yeah.
And then that's what adds to the whole, not to get into that, but of, damn, when you hear the stories and the shit that he went through, it's hard not to believe every single word he says. Like, we weren't a fly in that room, but my God, I don't think we would have really needed to be now seeing the movie that we saw.
You know what's funny about that? It's really insane to me because there's at least 90% of this movie that was already finished that he showed to the Warner Brothers executives. And they were just like, nah, we prefer doing Avengers 2.0, because that's what essentially the Whedon cut is. Like, they have all the intangibles of trying to flip what DC is. And for everybody out there that's confused about this, I see people being like trying to compare Marvel and DC, which I always think is a mistake. I think you should just accept both of them for what they are. They're comic books, essentially comic book characters. That should just be enough for you. This isn't anything other than that. It's comic book characters. DC is more prominently dark. The storylines are darker. The characterizations are darker. And Marvel, they kind of come upon their powers, where I'm freaking DC, parents are getting shot, planets are being destroyed, other kids are being abandoned, other characters are losing their parents in car crashes. In Marvel, it's a little bit more lighthearted than it actually supposed to be. So from the beginning, they should have never tried to go the route of being like, we have to be like MCU. MCU is successful because they did it first, and they did it great, and they made it there first, and that was their prize award of being in first place. You get to the door first, you open the door up, then you're there. And people also forget this, dude, as much as like me and you are like anti-Nolan in some aspects, the Dark Knight movies were coming out when the MCU was starting out, and you had no issue with that. Like, Dark Knight was killing it around the time Iron Man and the Hulk and Avengers was being built at the time. So, like, the fact that, like, at one point that this version of this movie was shown to multiple executives, and they were like, nah, man, Steppenwolf looks too scary. This movie's too long. I don't like the black suit. It makes no sense. Like, we need it to be more lighthearted. We need to have more comedic relief. It just, the whole thing with Hollywood nowadays is that they really want to like normalize superhero movies. But the whole reason about that, and the biggest difference in all that, is it's called superhero movies for a fucking reason, man. Like, I remember when Man of Steel came out, and all of a sudden critics randomly cared about fictional characters in a fictional city in Metropolis. Like, what are we doing? Like, they're not real, dude. They're comic book characters in the comic book world where clowns are throwing bombs at them and freaking scientists are throwing riddles and turning into ice. Like, none of this exists. So I really hated the whole buildup to this movie, because it just felt like it really seems like the general audience till this day still does not understand the actual concept of comic book and heroes in themselves. You know what I mean? Like, it's just insane to me. Like, Cyborg isn't just a Booyah Teen Titans Go character. The dude has trauma, just like every DC superhero and the plethora of DC superheroes you can go through. Like, the dude, yeah, he's funny in the cartoon Teen Titans Go. You know, him, Robin, we see all of them. It's fun. But in realization, if you pick up a fucking comic book and read a Cyborg anthology, you'll see that this guy, he has the power to do literally whatever he wants at any time he wants. So I really loved that, you know, for all the shit that Zach gets, and he's had his downfalls. We've seen the terrible movies. We've seen the good movies. He understands comic books. Like, I will honestly admit that right here on this podcast, he gets it. And he has the balls to be like, we're going to do it. We're going to flesh the whole entire thing out. Guess what? Superman has to kill Zod. Yeah, he does, because that's comic books, man. Guess what? In the 80s, he killed Zod too. He kicked him into a fucking tunnel that killed him. He didn't go back into the Phantom Zone. People seem to forget that about the original Superman. He literally killed Zod in that movie too. It's just funny how people seem to forget things the way they used to be. I don't think it's brainwashing. I've seen a lot of people be like, MCU brainwashed. No, I just think MCU got there first. You know what I mean? They did it first. Like, it was successful first. My whole thing about that is that MCU was already doing it when Nolan was giving us this realistic but also very dark DC universe.
Yeah. I think to add more to it, I think it's goes without saying that you really can tell someone nowadays, tell people apart from actual comic book fans to movie fans. If you've seen every Avengers movie, and every Marvel movie, everything, and you have all that knowledge, that's awesome. Mm-hmm. You have done your homework. You have no fucking life like the rest of us, and you've done it. Right? You know, but you can't then be like, no, I'm a huge comic book fan. No, you're not. Mm-hmm. Because if someone asks you anything about comic book that was not in a film, you're not going to know it. And then to almost act so like ignorant to be like, well, that part doesn't matter. It was in the movie. And it's like, motherfuck. Like, so I definitely get what you mean from that. And you definitely see the difference. And I think that's a lot of the time nowadays, people on the internet are people that just go to the movies or see the films and whatnot. Yeah. And then just think, oh, well, it was like, no. And I've definitely seen a lot of people trying to be like, oh man, they ripped off this from Marvel and they did this from I don't think it's that. And I mean, again, other directors, other films, stuff like that, you can tell when it's a blatant, like, just theft.
Yeah.
When you see Darkseid get stabbed in the neck or the shoulder with an axe, and you're immediately like, oh my God, they just stole it from Thanos getting stabbed. Not really, man. I think it's just like, how else are you supposed to take down the fucking pimpest fucking bad guy in the universe?
Who's not you even throw Darkseid at the time yet? Like, that's not even so, not armored. The one we see at the end of the movie isn't the Darkseid we get from that like history lesson.
And it's funny because when that scene first happened, I saw it instantly. I did think like, oh shit, look at this scene. You know what I mean? But I didn't think about it as in the way of being like, oh my God, look what they're doing. I just thought it kind of like, oh, that's kind of funny. Mm. And I kept carrying on. Like I feel like everybody else should do in any other movie. If that, you know. And snap Zod's neck. If in one of these movies Aquaman does that to somebody, I'm not going to instinctively just think, oh, well, he did it to that. That means it copied it. Mm. No, not necessarily. You take that, move along. Directors can borrow other director's stuff. Films will carry on as well.
Well, that's the thing about that.
Humorous like, thing that people...
Yeah. But it's like Joss Whedon. Like, he made Avengers. We know that. And it's like, but then you try to do that 2.0 with Justice League. So it's like... What you're comparing to now in the Justice League version, you have Steppenwolf, who's like obsessed with the mother boxes, but you don't really understand why. The whole fucking movie is like, oh, mother, I'm going to like connect you with the other three mother boxes. And it's like, he mentions Darkseid one fucking time in that version. And then you're like, oh, I guess he's doing it for Darkseid, or is he doing it because he loves his mother? Like, what the fuck is like, what are we doing here in this fucking movie, dude? Spoilers, by the way, but this is a spoiler review. He's literally like, I betrayed Darkseid. I tried to take the throne from him.
It was crazy hearing all of that. Instantly, I was like, what the fuck? Like, so again, when not to cut you off, minute I realized, like, oh, wow, this is a different film, was the subtle differences, but then not the not so subtle differences where you go from the original cut of, yeah, I guess this is the bad guy just because, you know what I mean? Like, more or less, you're like, oh, he's the main guy. Okay. Mm-hmm. And then this one, you basically realize, no, he's kind of the bitch of the group.
Oh, he's
always trying to fight for his way back in. You start seeing him do that. You're building off of this. You still see him getting, like, the shit side of the stick. You know what I mean? Like, it evolved instantly. And then
even the inclusion of like having Desaad be like the henchman for Darkseid, that even that was like good enough to be like, there's a reason behind it. Because in the beginning, it's like you watch the theatrical, you're just like, why is he here? Why the fuck does he care about them at all? Because I have to like put them together. And you're like, I get that. In this one, get spoilers, brother, you bring in the anti-life equation.
It's just about to say.
Changes it, everything. It changes the entire movie.
Yes.
Yeah. Now there's a point. There's a point
from that point on, it was a completely different movie. Not that it wasn't already prior to that, But that was one of the big moments, yeah, where you're like, okay, now this makes sense.
Yep, absolutely.
Now I see what they're trying to go for. Even before you think about possible sequels, possible things down the line, you just sit there and realize, okay, this is the story. This is what they're going towards. This is what may or may not happen.
Now it gives a reasoning. What, like, now yeah. I understand why Superman has to come back. It connects, like, all the things that, like, that were such left out. That was my biggest anger. Like, I'll be dead ass. You've always known I've always been pro DCEU because I believed in it. It's like the little train that could, you know. I'm like, I always hoped that they would do their
just
own
thing. Kept getting kicked down, but it just would not going, stop. Dude.
But, like, I remember going to the opening weekend for Man of Steel at the Block of Orange AMC.
Mm-hmm.
I remember being one of the only few people in that theater to mark out when I saw the LexCorp truck get destroyed. I remember marking out when the Wayne Enterprises satellite gets destroyed by Zod Superman. Because in my head, I'm like, holy shit, man. For the first time since Batman and Robin, there's a Batman in the Superman universe. Like, people seem to forget that. We've only seen Superman mentioned twice, kind of, in the Batman live action. The first time was Batman Forever with Val Kilmer when he mentions Metropolis. And you're like, oh, shit. Batman and Robin, you get that cringy ass scene with George Clooney being like, this is why Superman works alone. And that was the only time ever that we ever got fucking live action Batman saying anything about Superman. And here we are all these years later with Man of Steel. You get LexCorp and Wayne Enterprises.
Yeah.
Then we get BVS. Then we get Ben Affleck. And I remember this very clearly. Me and you were like the one of the only like very few people that were like excited about Ben Affleck as Batman.
Still to this day.
And that dude, that was already after The Town and Argo.
Oh yeah.
You're still blaming him for banging J-Lo and being in the freaking all these other terrible movies and Daredevil.
He's done worse. Way, he wasn't that J-Lo. Terrible.
Yeah, he's done way worse. Look at the back tattoo. Dude, the Daredevil wasn't even that bad to begin with. If it comes to just like preferences and performance wise, fucking Affleck did a killer job as Daredevil. But you're blaming him for other shit. He was Batman.
It's the same Ryan Reynolds aspect of he didn't play a shitty Green Lantern. He played a Green Lantern story. In a shitty movie. Yeah, he had a shitty script. He did not play a bad Green Lantern.
It was
he just had to shitty script.
And yeah, that's the downfall usually. Then BVS comes out. Loved it. Completely loved it. Suicide Squad was a misstep. We all know that. Yeah. They panicked after BVS. Wonder Woman kind of brought it back. Aquaman took it forward. Shazam, you can think what you want about that. Then we got the fucking theatrical Justice League. As a fan of it, as somebody that was cheering on for this little small market to get up there, it was a slap in the face as a fan because I knew this is not the way the trilogy ends. You can't give me BVS, no matter what problems you have with the end Man of Steel, and then try to turn it into something that it was never going to be. Like, it's not MCU. When you went from being this DCEU, Frank Miller inspired universe type of way, which was dark and very realistic as well, and then try to turn it into Iron Man and Captain America. They're good at what they do because they did it first and they killed it. Congratulations. Don't try to catch up. Make your own lane. And it took 5 years to get there. So sitting there watching it here at home, which is shitty because I wish I would have watched that at opening night theater, obviously. But with sitting here and seeing all those things, like seeing Batman Bruce actually go look for Aquaman in a way that makes sense, seeing him and Alfred actually working together to like look for everybody else, having the scene where Batman's like, literally, have faith, Alfred. That's character growth. That's a guy that understands
you. That's another like, big thing too. Yeah. To me, honestly, the additional scenes and dialogue with Alfred added so much more as well.
Absolutely.
Instantly made me love. I already enjoyed it, but I loved the connection between Affleck and Jeremy Irons as Batman and Alfred. Like, it was perfect. It was great. That was something that was missing.
Yeah, exactly. Even the scene where like Ben, they show up to the Batcave, and Ben Affleck, Bruce Wayne is like, I work for him. And Alfred's just like, yeah, I guess so. And he's building him the gauntlet. Dude, in the theatrical, Batman's like blocking the Parademon's guns. You're like, what? I'm like,
what's he doing? Yeah.
And in this movie, they're like, I got shit from the Kryptonian ship and I fucking put it in his armor. And it's like, there you go.
It was such a short scene of dialogue to add that additional clarity.
But just that it just adds so much more.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And that's the funnier thing again of just being. Being told either no, we're not going to do this or that, or just changing it just because whatever, you take away so much from the fucking story.
If I'm Warner Brothers, dude, I'm literally shaking right now because I've said it many times on this podcast in past episodes. They want to end the Snyder universe. Like that's mm-hmm. been their biggest gimmick. They want to give it to JJ. I understand that JJ's a phenomenal director. No hate towards him. But that's not gonna happen because this movie got heavily reviewed better than theatrical. People that care about Rotten Tomatoes, I think the theatrical is at 40%. And this version that's 75. And the audience score is at 97. And I think the theatrical is like at 70 or 60. And that's high because, like myself, we kind of faked the way we thought about the movie because we wanted to believe, you know, we wanted to be like, yo, they fixed it, but they didn't. It took 5 years to get to this point. This guy, and we've said it for fucking months, we knew this fucker was going to leave it off. And I mean that very respectfully, Zach.
Yeah.
We knew you were going to leave it on a cliffhanger. There was no way this could be the final part. It just can't. He added so much comic dialogue and footage and stuff like that. I never thought that I would ever see Darkseid, dude. Even after Thanos, I'm like, can anybody fucking do Darkseid?
Yeah.
This dude killed it, bro. Even just the Omega Beams in Atlantis, spoilers, but him literally killing Aquaman in Atlantis, it's like, that's Darkseid, bro. Bringing in the anti-life equation. One of the biggest comic book movie experiences of my life is hearing Steppenwolf, of all people, say anti-life equation and multiverse in the same sentence. That's insane, bro. That changes the complete experience between this and that.
Yeah.
It's a game changer. It's a game changer.
I like I said, it's very funny still that people, and it's fresh out there, so maybe that's why, but also just how people can kind of still try to, I'm not sitting here saying I'm Zack Snyder's biggest fan. Yeah. By no means am I saying that. But to argue that this movie wasn't good, wasn't well done, you know, would be just really kind of, again, you don't have to say it was the greatest movie ever. You know what I mean? Like, but to just, we've all seen bad movies. Does not have to be comic book movies. Does any style, any type. We've all seen a bad film. To watch something like this with the story and with how just the action, every little bit of it, mm-hmm. I think it's really, really ignorant and kind of hard to say that. There's definitely parts that you can say, I didn't really enjoy that as much, or I like this part better. Great. That's understandable. It's really hard to try to knock this film of a whole and be like, no. That's when I'm like,
you know what, man, it's one of the first, other than Endgame and Infinity War, it's one of the first movies to get like so hyped. And along the road, me and you have also been like, he's putting too much into it.
Mm-hmm.
But he found, you know, congratulations, bravo to Snyder, man. He found his footing. You know, it takes a while for some directors to get to that point where they're like, I understand what I need to do for a movie. And like, as a creator, you know, when it comes to podcast filming, you as a musician and then all this other world, we're all creators. To see somebody have a vision that taken from him, literally the studio blaming a family tragedy as the reason why they let him go. And then literally him being given the second chance, and not only giving me the second chance, but being like, I'm going to fucking just blow everybody's mind. And now he's in the position where like Warner Brothers has to kiss his ass to be like, yo, man, can you make more of this shit? Like, it's very like from creator to creator. It's like, fuck yeah, dude. Again, like you said, I'm not the biggest fan of all his movies. He's had his missteps, but it feels like this is the one where he was like, I'm going all in and I'm going to show you guys what you could have seen so long time ago. It's the first time in a long time where I feel, I guess, like content with what the final product actually was, to the point where I'm like, he gets it. And that's all you ever want from a director, somebody that actually understands these characters from a full perspective. Like this movie, dude, from beginning, middle, second part, first part, it all flows so well together. Now, trust me, he's had some crazy ideas. We've said it before, the fucking Batman, the Lois Lane pregnancy shit. That would have been something that I would heavily criticize him for, because that's
not definitely something I need. No.
But then you watch the movie and then you give me a scene where like Kal-El's in the ship and like you hear both of his fathers talking to him. That's a fucking moment, dude. That's the moment where you're just like, wow, dude, there's that character where we've seen him from, what he went through, he dies, he comes back. Lois is pregnant now, which is very injustice, and I'll get into that right now. And then you just have that scene where like all his, both of his dads, you hear him, he gets into the suit, he takes off, you get that reimagined scene for Man of Steel. That's a trilogy. That's how you close it off. That's the moment of a trilogy. Even Star Wars had that with the original trilogy. You have that scene with Vader and Luke where it's like, that's the conclusion. That was Superman's. And as much shit that Henry Cavill gets, man, that dude's, as beautiful as that man is, that motherfucker knows how to play a Kal-El. Like that.
Oh yeah.
Knows how to do.
And I think that's the biggest thing too. Not like just saying that, yeah, Warner Brothers should be doing more than kissing his ass. I think they're so stupid to still think and talk about recasting Henry Cavill. I think he is hands down the best Superman that we've seen played since Christopher Reeves. Yeah. I'll go on record and say that. The look alone, and like I've said before, jumping back to the fucking Whedon cut, one of the few things that I still stand by, or at least like sticks out to me, is when Superman comes back in that version and he's overly like campy. I liked it from a comic book fan standpoint.
Yeah.
But from the movie aspect, it made zero fucking sense. It was just funny to hear him like to the moon and da da da. Like
that was just I'm fine with him ending up at that point.
Yeah.
I feel like you need another movie for him to get to that. For him to be like, I'm reborn, and it's like, oh, now I'm campy. And it's like, wait, like
exactly
kind of like zombies Kal-El, dude. Like it doesn't really work like that.
Exactly. Yeah. Especially that quick and that. Going back to just being rushed, it didn't make any sense. Now going back to the whole pregnancy, they don't necessarily say it though.
Okay, I'm glad you brought that up because some people might have missed this. They show the pregnancy test.
Yes,
they show the scene where, by the way, as much as we're praising Cyborg and congratulations to Ray Fisher, beautiful job done. I love the storyline. I loved what. By the way, the dad. The actor that plays the dad, he's the same guy who plays the actor from Terminator 2.
I was going to say, I'm like, that guy needs to stay the fuck away from robotics. Yeah, dude, it's clearly
end of the world.
Clearly, he's the downfall of society.
You know, he got that robot arm and then everything changed and the Sarah Connor has to show up.
Yeah, we can't deal with this.
But bringing it back to that, Cyborg kind of sees what's going to happen. He doesn't say a fucking word because he's seen it, bro. He sees Darkseid show up. He sees him kill Aquaman. I'm assuming he kills Wonder Woman, even though they don't show how Wonder Woman dies. I Zach's a very big Star Wars fan, so I understand the Qui-Gon ending there with the fire. I'm like, you fuck, dude. I'm like, that's very connected. I know he loves the prequels, too. And I'm like, you gave Wonder Woman the Qui-Gon death, and I respect that a lot. I was like, that's ballsy to do. You get the scene of another Green Lantern dead. I don't know if you saw that scene.
Yep. Balrog, or yes. I might be mispronouncing that.
So but. I know I'm getting to the lowest lane thing, but just a fun fact: he wanted it to be Jon Stewart. Wonder Brothers.
Yes,
no, it can't be.
They're trying to save it, and
they try to get that, Reynolds. Yeah. I know, like I'm busy, understandably. Mm-hmm. So the guy's done a million things. He filmed the Jon Stewart, according to Zach.
Yeah, that's why
he was never allowed to post it. I'm sure we'll get it eventually. At this point, it's like let him run it with it. But the lowest thing, which brought me back to Injustice, we see the scene of Superman holding a skeleton.
Yeah.
You see kind of a baby bump, dude. If you like, you have to like really, you know how the Snyder fans are. They like break it down. Another thing though, towards the end of the movie, there's that scene where Martha Kent is moving back into the.
I know which part, yeah.
And Batman says, oh, by the way, congratulations.
Yep.
And that's where I'm like,
And I did catch that the first time. But I even thought real quick, like, hey, what? And then the movie progressed. So I was just like, whatever. Until I think yesterday or maybe today at some point, I had seen certain articles and stuff. And one of them pointed that out. And that's when I started thinking about it more. I'm like, well, did they say anything else prior to that? So, okay.
Those two scenes and the three, if you like zoom in. But like, there's the fans that like take like every scene and get apart where I'm just like, holy shit, I didn't even notice it the first time. So she is pregnant. Thank God it's not Bruce's, like originally planned. Even though Zach, I don't know why, but he still mentioned that like Clark and Lois's son was going to be the next Batman.
Yeah.
And I'm still like, wait, why? Why would he do that?
Just be
Superman 2? Like, I don't know what the fuck.
Well, I mean, I guess at that part or at that point, they're saying that the kid comes out normal. He's not an alien. He's not half Kryptonian. He's nothing, which I'm like, okay, I guess in the weird sense that just because you're an alien and you knock a chick well, up, it doesn't necessarily mean
like,
you're gonna
have why would you make him Batman? Like,
I mean if you're gonna have a normal kid, you can't necessarily just put a cape on him and be like, all right, you're super, like he's gonna die real quick.
Well, yeah, but that brings us to the epilogue, which is probably, as a comic book fan, and y'all know me,
this is gonna hurt both of us, I think. Yeah, and we might lose some viewers and listeners after this one.
You know what's funny is though, like my Joker videos always do like the best out of all.
Oh yeah, that's not surprising
and
at all.
And so a lot of you people know I've
criticized you people Leto. Love Joker, so here we go, guys.
Yeah, fucking A. Everybody knows by this point. I think the Joaquin Phoenix's reactions are like the most viewed on my channel. I've criticized Leto's Joker a lot, man. But I'm a sucker, bro. You give me Batman Joker dialogue, I will pay whatever you want me to pay, and I will be there to witness it. For the first time in how many years that they casted this dude as the Joker, it was very, very passable. There were some things between that. Here's the thing. The biggest line from that whole scene between Leto's Joker and Affleck's Batman, which was insane, we filmed in November. It's insane to think about. They filmed this in November, which Zach mentioned that he wasn't supposed to film anything new.
Yeah.
He called Jared. They're like, fucking Roberto, let's get there. Give him a boy that prays Deathstroke. He's like, fuck it, let's get there. There's a scene where this dude says, where Leto's Joker says, which I'm like, that's the greatest, one of the greatest line from any Joker live action. You rip this card up. I'm happy to discuss why you would send a boy wonder to do a man's job. And I'm like, bro, that is Joker greatness right there. As much as I can dislike him, no tattoos, long hair, smeared makeup, laugh, I'm still not sold on. But you say boy wonder to send a man's job, I'm like, I'm there.
We already talked about off the air, and I'll say it on the air. My biggest thing is, you know, at the end of the day, whether I'm a fan of his or not, would I love to see another Joker in his shoes? Absolutely. But I can't argue that the dialogue alone was amazing, was great to hear from the Batman Joker standpoint. If I was reading a comic and those exact words and everything were in it, I would have had the same reaction.
Yeah.
So I have to, in a roundabout way, say, hey, Jared, you did something right, I guess. You know, I'm being like stabbed in my side as I say that. But it definitely was far better than the 15 to 20 minutes that we saw in Suicide Squad.
Oh,
it's really insanely, I'll go on record and not care. It's instantly better than whatever original fucking cut of his Suicide Squad he says there is. There's no way that any more Jared Leto from that version Joker that I would enjoy it.
But how funny would it be if it was?
I'd be pissed off. But I'm going to try to stand by my shitty criticism right now and say no.
I'm just saying.
I don't think it would, because I think easily alone, Zack Snyder, like you already said, has a much different mind. I think you would have seen more of the Joker and maybe different, but I don't think it would have been the different that we saw from Snyder.
I think
respectfully,
this is from what I've heard, so take it with a grain of salt. They might do the Ayers cut.
I mean, if they do it, they do it. At this point, well, I would not be shocked.
Watch it be that Joker, and I'm gonna be like, they're like, don't make me like it.
But unless he went back and shot everything new as well, and then I'm like, you might as well just call it a Joker movie and say it's a brand new fucking film.
It would take a lot, because again, he agreed with the way he looked. You know what I mean? That's why I'm like, how the fuck does Zach understand how the Joker should look and behave? And a few months, and you were like tattoos and grills and gangster.
That's
shit.
What I'm saying.
Yeah,
that's what I'm saying. Is where I would need to really. It would take some, convincing to really believe that any other script, any other version of Jared Leto's Joker as of right now was any different than Suicide Squad, other than Zack Snyder, because here, like you said, he literally had a fresh canvas to just be like, all I want is the same actor.
Yeah, but not that.
That was basically it.
Yeah.
He literally, and again, yeah, the laugh is pretty much the same.
Yeah.
The way he talks is similar, but it was not the same.
The delivery was different.
Yeah, yeah. It was not just, and again, the easy thing they can say is, well, it's supposed to be in, you know, a dystopian, distant future and whatnot.
But still,
either way, I don't think they would have changed it that. And I don't know if they actually have said it yet, but I won't be surprised if they do. This is not the same Joker. You know what I mean? Like, if Snyder can be like, that was this version, whatever, I wouldn't be shocked if they're like, no, these are two different worlds. That had nothing to do.
That would make complete sense because we see the Flash at the end there really go farther into the Speed Force than he's ever gone to. So, like, that Flash movie, I think they have to change everything now, but that Flash movie, you could really sew in different things you want to. But that's the thing. That's like, if you're going to have Steppenwolf mention multiverse, then do the multiverse. Don't just mention it and do nothing with it, because you could have your Snyder universe and you could have your other Batmans and Supermans and whatever you want to do. Like, if you want a theatrical one, only HBO Max, you have the villain of a Justice League movie that's supposedly marketed to be like the biggest streaming thing ever at this point.
Yeah.
Then just do it. Like, you have a complete, like you said, with when it came to Zach and Leto, open canvas. You could literally just throw whatever you want on there. It's HBO Max. Like, if you want to compete with them, like Netflix and Disney, I really do think that they have really, they shouldn't have any issue to like just pull the trigger on that. But going back to that Joker Batman scene, to hear Boy Wonder, to hear Robin and be like, how many people are you going to let die? It's very like Frank Miller, Batman Joker.
Yeah.
Like, how many people have you let like pass away under your watch? Like, what would happen if you sacrificed yourself? Like, that's Joker dialogue. And just hearing Batman, especially Batfleck, be like, you do know when I held Harley in my arms.
And her that was good.
Breath, it's the delivery of Ben Affleck, man, to just be like, her last breath was like, for me to kill you. And believe me, I will fucking kill you. But to do it slowly, it's like, oh, bro.
Hearing Batfleck say fuck more than once was like, wow, like the cherry on top to once again, fuck you to all the Batfleck haters. I'm so done with that shit.
I would take him back with open arms, dude. If you ever like, I want to be Batman, he gets like, give him everything he wants.
Like, I'll buy a Batman costume if you want to come act in our movie, Affleck. It's not going to be good, but. But you can wear this. You can wear this costume, Dane fucking night, dude.
And we're so cheap. We won't CGI out the back tattoo.
No, dude, you can have it. I don't give a shit. Just do everything you did in this film, back tattoo and all. We'll put the back tattoo on the fucking suit. I don't care.
So let's throw this out there. What do we think happens to get to that point?
To get Affleck in our movie.
But it would take probably J-Lo. She's single now. Thanks, A-Rod.
Okay, that's true. Yeah.
Yeah. No, obviously it's a nightmare scene, but you have to think that's what would be next. Unless they do, because I talked about this with somebody. I was like, what if they do this one and then second one is Legion of Doom? Because obviously Lex has to be involved in it. Because we still get that Lex Deathstroke scene where he's like Batman.
Which was so much better. So much better.
Yeah, because it was stretched. It was like faster. It got to the point.
Well, yeah. I enjoyed that scene in the original because I remember just being like, wow, that's fucking cool. And it's interesting. It probably was.
It was.
And I remember being like, that's interesting. But back then, knowing what we knew, that it was already a very, very slim chance that they were going to continue, it was enough for me to be like, well, that fucking sucks. But with this one, where we already more or less going into it, we knew that this was not going to lead to a sequel or another film at the time. The way they did that scene, and then even the additional, technically the movie has, I guess, two ends if you think about it.
Yeah, it's
it has that. It has that one, Deathstroke. Yeah. Well,
Deathstroke is the end credit for the theatrical.
Yeah. So in the Snyder cut, you have, you know, buying the farm back. This very similar stuff. Everybody's happy. Then it fades, and correct me if I'm wrong, doesn't it go into the Lex Deathstroke?
It goes into a cop officer, Gotham Arkham Asylum doctor being like, yes. Lex.
That's right.
It's not Lex, they're just somebody screaming, cuts screen, to a okay. boat scene. You see Deathstroke on a boat
yes.
meeting Lex.
So already it's stretched out because they had that original scene of them calling to Lex and then turning him around and he's crazy.
Yeah.
But it was quicker. It was much, yeah. much quicker. I remember just being like, you know what I mean? And then it cuts to the boat scene. And I remember the same thing when I'm in the theaters watching it, when you just see the back of his helmet. And as a fan, you know.
Yeah.
I remember being like, holy shit.
Yeah, best and thing
then,
in the movie.
Yeah, yeah it's the- it easily. So back to Snyder's version. Seeing that scene again leading up to it, I'm like, okay, cool. This is going to be that. And then they start saying different dialogue. And I'm like, oh, okay.
Yeah, because
this
is cool. In the Josh, I remember it being like, I know who,
he,
I know who Batman is. And then he's like, what if we... The last thing Lex says is like, what if we have our own Legion?
Well, I was going to say, I remember that. I don't even remember him mentioning Batman to Deathstroke in the... Oh, he does?
Like, he's like, I know how to get the bat.
And he's okay.
Like, he's like, but what if we have our own Legion? And this one, yeah. like, Batman's Bruce Wayne.
And he says it. Nothing about a team. About Legion.
Yeah.
And honestly, it's better. I'm like, don't do that yet. Or don't even say something like that. Because I feel like, especially now, we're jumping back and forth. But especially now with it still ending, going with the door open of being like, Darkseid's coming still.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I think it'd be kind of dumb to have, if say they did get a sequel, to not just have it be Darkseid or at least something else leading to him. I think if it was the Legion of Doom, like it was rumored to be, I'm just like,
and from maybe. from what Zach would want, I think his Legion of Doom has Deathstroke, Riddler, Black Manta.
Yeah, another Aquaman villain. I think I remember.
What's the cold one from Flash? I forget his fucking name.
Oh,
Killer Frost, right? Or am I wrong about that?
The, isn't it just Captain Cold or some stupid shit?
Yeah, some shit like that. Yeah, and the one from Flash, and then somebody from Wonder Woman, and that was going to be the scene because okay. originally, according to Zach, is Luther's the reason why Lois dies, and that's what triggers the anti-life equation, which has Darkseid control Superman to like take over everything. But my whole thing is like, you hear Leto's Joker be like, you're the reason why she died, dude. Like, we wouldn't be in this world if you didn't have her die.
Yeah,
like, and it's like, so my whole thing is like, is it Luther or is it Injustice Joker that like kills her off?
Well, that's the funny thing I heard. So again, we're winding down, but we're getting to like the questions of like the end of the movie, because again, everybody's different watching the film. I was looking forward to the epilogue the entire fucking time. I knew he was going to do that. I had a feeling, and then like random thought halfway,
like I said, like when Cyborg does the thing where he's trying to like disconnect the mother boxes and it goes into it, I'm like, oh, this is going to be the nightmare scene. Then we only get the Wonder Woman's dead, fucking Darkseid just kills Aquaman with ease, and then you get the Lois Lane dead, get Darkseid behind them putting his hand on her, which is, by the way, bravo to Snyder. He literally lose scenes from Man of Steel to put into that scene, which I'm like, that's just bravo directing to be like, we'll just reuse it, bro. And then followed by, you see the scene where Superman holding the mask of Batman, which we saw in BBS. That was cool. Yeah.
And then so it's almost like we're seeing the after of that.
Another thing, though, we also see the Joker card cut in half.
I did not catch that.
And in the beginning, in the ending, when we see Joker Batman, Joker says,
he gives,
anytime you want to cut this in half, I'll gladly tell you why the boy wonder.
Pretty much, he's
a man's job. He killed the Joker. Yeah.
I was going to say, basically, what he's saying is, you tear this card up, fucking, let's go.
Yeah.
So. Oh man, I did not catch that. Brilliant on you once again, Hollywood.
It's one of those things, dude. This movie is very Tarantino-ish, where it's like rewatchable to be like to pinpoint
all of
it together. Yeah.
So okay, that's good. That's fucking.
We also get the scene of Mara, where she's like literally holding. She has to have like a jug of water with her at all times. And she's like, let him come because I'll just like shank him. And Batman's just like, I understand your pain.
And like, you know, it's funny. I caught the water. I didn't put that together. And I feel really fucking stupid.
Well, according to Zach,
like of course she needs water. She's a fucking fish.
Right? Well, that's the thing. Like, Darkseid literally just brought all the water away. Like, he destroyed Atlantis completely, which I'm like, fuck yeah, dude. Like, that's Darkseid.
That's fucking, oh my God. That was lost on me too. That's See, shit, man, that's good.
Like, guys, honestly, I'm three watches in, like, to the point where I'm content with the movie just being like, this is what comic book movies should be like the comic.
Yeah, books. Well, you see, okay, we gotta keep going on this ending scene before we call it a podcast.
Yeah,
and obviously we made the point of, one, this is a very, very spoilery review, discussion, kind of just synopsis of the film. Give it or take it or leave it. Our opinions are only ours. Share it to the world. Mm-hmm. But going forward with that, I do wish we could have seen, because I love that after the whole discussion with him and the Batman Joker, Batman walks away to Deathstroke. Deathstroke is like, you know, shooting the shit, but he even says, like, you really think it's a good idea we brought him? I really wish we could have seen or had something like elaborate of, like, how are he and Deathstroke working together and why, you know what I mean? Especially going from, like, the ending of the film, which is set in, like, the present day for them, you know?
Dude, there's a world, there's a multiverse that we live in where Warner Brothers didn't fuck this up.
I was going to say,
Adam Driver was going to be our Riddler.
And originally he was up for Lex Luthor.
Yeah, and then
that's just funny.
Zach changed it for him to be Riddler for the Legion of Doom.
Okay,
I can
buy that.
We were gonna get Deathstroke and Riddler versus Batman, Batfleck originally. The reason why Ben dropped off is because Geoff Johns, who was in control of the DCU, he was just like, "No, we gotta do like New 52 shit." Mm-hmm. And Ben's like, "I kind of want to do more Frank Miller shit."
Yeah,
and when
he did.
Yeah, and when Warner Brothers was more like, we want to do New 52, that's when Ben was like, I don't want to do that aspect of Batman.
He's like, I'm going to go home and drink.
Yeah, like, I'm good. I'm going to get divorced and go bang some new Hollywood starlet, and I'll be content. But, like, there's a world where we see Adam Driver.
He really is Bruce Wayne, isn't he? He
literally is. He's live action. Either him or Clooney. It's one of the two.
Yeah.
They trade off on weekends. I think now it's Ben, though, because I think George got married. So George is, like, retired.
No, George.
Retired Bruce, having Damian, and Ben is, like, Frank Miller's Bruce. He's like, I have no meaning in life. I need Carrie Kelly to come into this so that everything can make sense.
So clearly, Ben Affleck was the true method actor of the Zack Snyder.
Was the Batman. Another thing, Martian Manhunter did not look as bad as I thought it was going to look. He had the
egg,
and I'm like, you know what? He shows up firstly as we all knew, this was the original, as him showing up as Martha Kent and being like talking to Lois and being like, you need to come back to reality. We see him. Obviously, we all know Martian Manhunter lost his wife and his kid, so he knows from experience. Another big, as a Batman fan, like a Batman fan, dude, for Martian Manhunter to show up and talk to Bruce and be like, your parents would be proud of you. I choked up a little bit because I'm like, that's everything that Bruce Wayne in any incarnation ever, dude, Adam West, all the way to him, has ever wanted to hear. Like, ever.
Yeah.
That's true. Always ever wanted. Just hear his parents be like, we're proud of you. For Martian Manhunter to be like, yo, Bruce Wayne, your mom and dad are proud of you. I was like, that's literally all I've ever wanted to see from any Batman, because that gives him closure more than anything. Yeah. He's a guy who's been through hell and back.
He's like, I don't need to hear Alfred say it anymore. I don't fucking believe him.
You fucking
alien. This alien that I've never met before in my life. No, but the funny thing about, and that's, it really is, like, jokes aside, it really is a cool scene, but very, very cool on that aspect alone, because I felt the same way where I'm like, oh, that's a fucking, just, that's just good. And that wasn't newly shot. That was original shooting, right? Or was that whole scene new?
That was new. You could see,
I thought.
You want to know how you can see? He looks so much skinnier, Ben.
He looks so much skinnier.
Okay. Yeah, that's
exactly what I thought.
It was a new scene in November that
they shot. So that's cool alone of itself and everything. Mm-hmm. Going back to the scene where he's Martha talking to Lois and whatnot, I don't know if it's really alluded to it, but now knowing how he talks to her and says, like, you got to go back to reality, you got to do this, does he know the nightmare scene too?
I think he does, only because after Ben has the nightmare,
he shows up.
But Bruce has a nightmare. He shows up and he's like, the anti-life equation is here.
And he says Darkseid's coming again. And,
like, he's still coming. Like, he's not like, he's still coming. And if you, and like, it's time for me Like, cool, Martian, you've had, like, since Man of Steel to show up. But anyways, like, it's like, it's time for me to defend Earth. And Bruce is like, it's like, no, you know, when he fought Zod and Darkseid and all these motherfuckers, you're like,
maybe I could have stopped him from snapping that alien's neck.
It's like, you know, in BVS when I accidentally nuked Superman, I probably could have stopped that. Like, I could have changed.
He's like, I saw you driving around all, like, town. You were tired. I could have picked you up.
I was like, but I didn't, because I'm like, this isn't my world. So he gets to that scene where he's like, at the anti-life equation is here, which is like, for as a fan, dude, I remember watching Justice League Unlimited. Mm-hmm. And there was that one episode where Lex Luthor found the anti-life equation, him and Darkseid team up together. To hear that in a movie, it's just like, holy shit, bro. Like, now I understand the mother boxes. Now I get this whole thing. Like, there was a bigger fucking picture in this whole fucking movie, and you never gave it to us till 2021. And I'm like, and now guess what, motherfuckers? Like, you're going to have to continue to keep going as much as you hate this guy. Like, for once in your life, realize there's a multiverse for a reason. Like, you could have your cake and eat it. Have HBO Max give him the movie budget that he needs, which was $70 million for this one, and just fucking run it back, because there's so many stories you could tell. You could have a Martian Manhunter series. You could have the actual Batfleck series. Like, you could do,
like, watch HBO Max just turn into like what DC Network was supposed to be before HBO Max just bought it.
Yeah, but now you have literally the doors open to build everything.
Here's
my thing. I think the nightmare scene at the end happens if Lois dies, like, because you hear Jared's Joker be like, how many more people have to die before you sacrifice yourself? Like, you're the one to let Lois die. And it's like, it's one of those things where you're just like, oh shit, I don't know how he does it. Another cool thing, again, I probably watched way into this more movie than the normal person would be, and when Superman is holding the skeleton of Lois, in the background you see the Robin suit that says ha ha ha, joke's on you. So it's in the Batcave when it happens.
Fuck.
Take that for what it is, but it's in the Batcave when Lois dies. If they pull the trigger for that, which is very Injustice, it's in the Batcave, which makes more sense about him, you know, blaming.
Going after him and whatnot. Yeah. Yeah, that's a fucking movie, man.
4-hour movie.
It's again, dude, film.
From creator to creator, it's very cool to see somebody be like, I had a vision, fucking ripped out of my hands. They use literally a family tragedy to be like, we don't need you anymore. We got Josh. He's going to do a good job. And then be like,
he's going to be nice to all the female cast members.
Shout to Buffy. And then fucking years later, they're like, you want to come back for HBO fucking Max? And he's like, yeah, sure. I'll finish your fucking movie that you didn't want me to finish. And then he's like, it's better. It's so much better than everything you ever thought it was going to be, because this guy, as much as you hate him, and I know a lot of people do, because now I'm seeing like critics on like TikTok and Twitter be like very nitpicky, dude. And where they're to the point where like their biggest complaint is the Wonder Woman shit, where like, you know, like the Egyptian music's like playing in the background. I'm like, if that's your biggest complaint, then shut the fuck up, because it didn't work.
Like, what the fuck did you want? Like Cardi B playing or some stupid that's shit?
Like, well, WAP playing? Like, dude, like it worked. As much as like, I get why they would want JJ to do the next DCEU or whatever. I'm like, this guy, he kind of gets it. And you know what? Give him the credit. He fucking had the balls to do what you fuckers didn't want to do. And he completed it. It's like, this guy probably made one of the best zombie movies of our generation.
And he gets just talking about that.
Yeah. Like, he probably did. Honestly. Like, all you motherfuckers that freak out about Walking Dead, go watch Zack Snyder's fucking zombie vision. And that shit's like,
I mean, at the end, just to talk on that real quick, I'm like, easily one of the best remakes of any genre, but any, if you're sticking with the horror, it's easily one of the top 10, maybe top 5 best remakes ever.
Fucking in the zombie world, where people still, like, in 2021 freak out about Walking Dead, it's like, that's like highly quality zombie fucking movies. He gets it. He just does. And for Warner Brothers, because I know very well, they didn't want to continue this. Good luck. You have to at this point. You need to give him the keys to his own car and just let him finish what he has to do, because there's obviously an audience. If Warner Brothers is still like, no, then fucking more power to you. You guys fuck money, because now you have a chance to make a shit ton, bro. And as crazy as it sounds, because I never thought we'd get to this point, there's a kind of a light at the end of this pandemic tunnel. And theaters are opening up like crazy. Like, I already know, like, fucking King Kong and Godzilla is supposed to make a shit ton. That's supposed to be the first marquee movie that, like, hits the movie theaters. And then I think it's Mortal Kombat and Black Widow, if anybody still cares about that. We still have...
I don't, but...
No, I don't either. But you continue the shit. Give him the keys, man. He obviously proved that in 5 years that he's grown as a director more than anything, and he gets it. And it's a superhero movie where, as a comic book fan, as a Frank Miller fan, I'm like, hell yeah, dude. And my thing is, like, I know The Flash is going to change a lot. I mean, yeah. they already cast the Supergirl. You got Michael Keaton's Batman. That's right. It's like, but don't change enough to be like, you got to give us the dark side shit, dude. Like, even when the trailers came out, before the movie even released, me and you were like, fucking dark side Omega beams? That's enough to be just all into it. Mm-hmm. Then you have it in Atlantis. It's like, that's comic book, like, high anticipation comic shit. So I'm all in, man. I really do think they need to, like, continue this. There's no way you could just, like, brush it off. Gotta go.
Yeah. In some way, yeah. If HBO Max just either looks at it almost like doing, like, a series that it's exclusive to that, you know, film it however way you want, continue doing it in parts, maybe eventually release it in parts if that's the route they really want. I just think there's definitely got to be some talk going on. And if and when theaters start opening up, I have no doubt that they'll put it into theaters probably. And if they do.
So far I've heard there's a black and white version coming out in a few
weeks. Okay.
And then I think he does want to release it in IMAX in some capacity.
See, whatever, you know, records of money they get for those, because I'm sure people are going to go out and see it. You know what I mean?
The first numbers that came out, I think Brazil said that this movie was 140% literally more, like, rented than any movie ever. And I'm just like, good luck, dude. Like, you can't close the door on it. You just have to just accept it. Like, you might be hating on it and be like, this is not the vision we have, but, like, dude, this is the vision that's here. Like, just let it happen.
This is what's going to make you money, and this is what's going to make films or stories or whatever the fuck you want to do. But it's, there's too much to kind of leave really, really on the table other than being like, oh, when X-Men and everything got bought by Disney, and that's when they had to be like, well, we're done with that fucking versions of it. You know what I mean? It's that style. That's why I'm like,
this is not comparable to Dark Phoenix. It's like, this is
it's one of those things where I'm like, you can easily do something from this. And if they choose not to, I don't see the point of that. But
there's obviously
now we're at the part of the what if.
There has to be a nightmare movie. There just has to be.
Yeah.
There just has to be. There's obviously an audience for it. I think people want to see that version of Ben. I don't know how crazy Ben wants to come back as Batman. I know George Clooney told Ben never to be Batman.
Yeah.
That was, like, his one advice to him. But, like, George, you got a terrible director. It's kind of different. But it's interesting, man. There's just this guy, for his credit, he went all out, and good for him. You know, I mean, he had every right to. I loved it. To give it a score, because I always give the movie scores, I'm going to give it an 8 out of 10. I'm going to stick it there. Let's say it as a fan, as somebody that's always been DCEU, it helped me complete the trilogy. Because now I can go back, watch Man of Steel, BVS, and Justice League and get it. You know what I mean? And now my only nitpick is that, like, now I'm kind of like, I do want the next part of it. You can't show me Darkseid in a boom tube with Granny Godness and Desaad, and then Superman and Wonder Woman and Batman looking back at him and not pull it off. Like, that has to be the next part. And for everybody that's like, oh, they're copying, because this is, I shit you not, this is straight facts, you can look it up. There's a lot of people being like, they're copying the Infinity Gauntlets. Come on, read a comic, guys.
No.
Like,
the
mother boxes were first, technically.
Yeah.
And
so it's different. It's different enough
without Darkseid being there.
Very, very true.
Kirby made both.
Yep. But just from the film standpoint alone, I'm like, it's, they're different enough. And how many, you know what I mean? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's why I'm like, at the end of the day, in comic book universes, how many different ways do you want the fucking main bad guy to have to control the world? He's got to collect something.
Like, yeah, that's like if Van de Gaulle anti-life equation, that's the biggest thing.
Yeah,
anti-life is just insane. The fact that we're talking about that in a superhero movie is just fucking nuts. It's just insane.
Yeah, I know, right?
That, like, Steppenwolf, no matter how he looks, it's like, you mentioned anti-life and the multiverse. It's like, I get you, bro. Like, we're there. Like, this is what I've been waiting for. It's like, you finally pulled the fucking trigger. It's like, fuck CW.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
I would still like for them to do Flashpoint, though, at some point. I think there's some stuff, yeah, you could connect together. I'd much rather see Joaquin's Joker in this universe than any Joker that they could bring back. Obviously, not Heath, rest in peace.
So obviously, no pun intended.
No pun intended. But... that book's been closed for a while, but... If they can bring
Walt Casket, whichever, but
Superman.
We did so well, and then we got to the end, and then we just started shitting on Heath Ledger for some odd reason. People are like, "What the fuck,
dude?" Hopefully, he doesn't have his dad's picture in his too. Like, fucking.
I'm like, I swear, we like kind of didn't. It just kind of happened.
It wasn't deliberate. My point is, it's gonna be interesting, man. Like, the ball is, it's on Warner Brothers' side. Like, you could either be like, nah, we're good, JJ, reboot everything. Or you could be like, multiverse, there's two lanes, and we could do both. And nobody's really going to be mad at us. Like, we could have the Black Superman, and that could still be really cool because it's not really Kal-El. And we could still have Henry Cavill's Kal-El and Ben Affleck's Batman while watching fucking Robin Pattinson do his thing. Like, we could do all of it. And at some point, if we want a Flashpoint, which now, after watching that movie, as much as I'm going to love seeing Keaton back in the bat suit, I'm like, I don't want fucking Ben's story to be fucking.
I'm up. Like, not yet. Not just yet. I want to see that. Don't get me wrong. I want to see Keaton back. But yeah, I'm not ready. As fitting as an end to the film that it was, and a nice like dialogue and everything, like we already said, it's not enough to really be like, and that's the last time Affleck was Batman. Now I'm like, fuck.
Well, not even that. It's the scene with fucking Martian, or we.
Like, yeah, that's what I'm saying.
It's like, that's like skinny just, fat.
Yeah,
you lost so much weight.
Yeah, no.
It's like, I know you have a new Latin girlfriend, but you didn't have to lose that much weight. You fuck,
like, you gotta get fit. Dark side's coming.
No, man, good movie. I think for once, other than Marvel, this is the first movie where I'm like, the weight and the struggle. Like, you gotta remember, dude, there was petitions, there was planes.
There was a lot of shit.
Yeah. Flying over Comic-Con with banners being like, release the Snyder Cut. They won, dude. Like, give them credit for credits. Do they fucking Zach
was nerds, like, gotcha. Nerds will fucking rage, man. When they want something, they will fucking tell you. And
there it is.
Apparently, if enough people listen, you get it. So
it's interesting, man. Tomorrow is, well, when this podcast goes up, by then it's trade day because that's Monday. We're filming this on Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
By tomorrow, we should know what this is going to, because if the numbers are as huge as I'm hearing it is, I completely see tomorrow be like deadline of Rarity or E! News being like, yeah, we're doing part two.
And Zach's like, this just in, Jonah Hill as Superman. Yeah, like, oh, fuck, dude.
It's interesting, man.
Which is funny. I could see them talking about how much like it made and them saying like thank you and great. I don't know if I see them saying anything about, even if it's actually in talk or like agreed on. I don't see them. If they're smart, they should hold off on it just a bit. If they're gonna do it, you know what I mean? Like, if they tell people right now immediately, I'm in that bad state of mind where I'm like, but what if they say it now and then something fucking happens? I'm like, don't fucking get my hopes up.
So you're a better man than I am. I've been hurt so many times at Warner Brothers. I'm still like,
yeah, you're like
I still have hope. They can't do it again. Like, there's no way. It was a good movie for once with so many subscribers. We're going to get part two. And I guarantee you tomorrow they're going to be like, oh, JJ's doing like Batman. It's like, fuck.
they're not coming back.
It's like, hey, we gave you literally, dude. And his, remember, we talked about this when it leaked on Tom and Jerry. Remember the rumor was the CGI was bad? I'm like, fucking Darkseid looked amazing.
Yeah, like, that's actually, yeah, really funny. People were really trying. And that's those times where I'm like, I'm so not a conspiracy theorist about anything. But those were really those times where I'm like, how many fucking Warner Brother plants were on the internet that day just being like, how many fucking bullshit tweets can we send out?
And I said, like, how many of you guys have like the tinfoil conspiracy theory Joe Rogan bullshit where you're just like, they're trying to sabotage the movie. And then I watched the movie and I'm like, holy shit, they're trying to sabotage the fucking movie. Like, dude.
So like, I'm like, oh shit. Dude,
that's the perfection of Darkseid, dude. Even the scene where, like, where Superman's holding Lois, you see Darkseid in the background, you see the Omega beams still coming out of his eyes, but not fully. And he doesn't, like, trust it until he grabs, like, Kal-El's shoulder, and he's like, I got this, dude. And that's, like, the biggest thing where I'm like, holy dude, like, if the CGI was bad, it would have been, like, all over the fucking place.
Yeah.
As like, he killed that. Like, that wasn't even a new scene. Like, he literally took a scene from Man of Steel and put that into that scene. Which I'm like, fucking Zach, dude. Like, good for him. Good for him, man. I'm happy for that guy. Like, just to be able to be like, they fucked you guys over. Fuck the big market bullshit, like, studios. Like, Disney does their own thing. And Kevin Feige runs Marvel, and Disney's Disney. Even though that fucker's very soon going to run Star Wars, too, because he's already got his foot in the door. Good for him.
Owns it all, man.
At this point, yeah, dude.
Yeah.
Feige's going to be probably owning everything at some point, but probably Sony real soon, depending how the Spider-Man movie goes. It's insane to see one director be like, because me and you, we've seen so much hype between every fucking movie ever, dude. It's very hard to like live up to that like expectation. Fucking credit to Zach, dude. He did it. Mm-hmm. He pulled it off. He gave us not only a better movie, better Batman, better Superman, better Wonder Woman, a way better Cyborg. Flash, that's probably my one nitpick. I'm still on the fence with Ezra's Flash.
Yeah.
There were scenes where I did not enjoy as much as I thought I would. And that's probably the only
character. He still just doesn't, I don't know. And maybe now that's the only like a Marvel aspect I will try to be like, maybe. I saw a lot of like him trying to kind of take the similarities of Quicksilver, of he has to be the overly weird, funny, ha-ha, like jokey kid.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I get it, I guess. But then also I'm like, no, you know, like, I don't know. Definitely he was the least or the... not, I don't want to say weakest necessarily, but he definitely was the least character that I was invested or like interested in watching. Weakest. Yeah, I mean,
yeah, he was the weakest to me. It just like his character, like to me at least, and I'll probably get shit for this, the Flash would be like Spider-Man, where there's similarities to there. It's just so Mary Jane, Iris West. There's a lot of similarities between the Flash and Spider-Man. Ezra's just more like cringy comedy, which I'm just like, he's trying to pull something over. Like the hot dog scene, which I'm just like, okay,
yeah, dude.
I'm like, like, you saved the girl. That should be the scene itself. But then you have to be like, I got the hot dog. And it's like,
well, and that, like, you already have the scene with him and his dad, which I think is fine. I think it's both of them.
Who's not going to be
not coming back. Yeah.
Billy.
So that's a bummer. But, so those scenes alone, I felt like were enough. And then the additional, you know, add on, instead of him going to Russia for some fucking random reason, you have him going through the Time Force and the Speed Force and starting everything. And that whole scene alone, even the dialogue of him saying like, if this, I'm messing it up, but basically saying like, I just want my dad to know, like, I was something.
He has a very like John Connor, Sarah Connor line during that scene where he's like, the future is not set or some shit.
Yeah.
I make my own future or something like that, which I'm like, I hated the Russian family. And
it was so random. It was so very, very, very random.
They had that cheap scene where they're like parademons and like the little girl takes like bug spray and they're like,
exactly.
The same Buffy, bro.
Like, yeah, pretty much. It was just really, really, yeah. So, I mean, I think he was better in this one. Obviously, everybody was, but it's definitely going to take some more convincing. And if and when the Flash movie comes out and it's Flashpoint or something else, hopefully he just.
It all looks like it's going to be Flashpoint. I mean,
I don't know how else it would be. So
that's the thing. I don't know, man. This movie changed a lot of of what you can do or where you can go. Cause I'm like, if Warner Brothers thought that this will fucking shut them the fuck up and they'll be done with this universe and we can move on. I don't think so, dude, because Restore the Snyder Cut is trending heavily every fucking day now because they're there's an audience for this shit. People want to see what's next. And you saved kind of Leto's Joker. Now there's a world where you can have a solo Cavill movie before all this shit happens. Because if you remember in the ending of that epilogue, he comes back in the red and blue suit instead of the black and silver suit, which I'm just like, okay, so what happens to get to that point? Or where does... It's just too many options. It's amazing to me, dude, how somebody watched this movie, some executive, and it was too dark. And it's bro, you had that there. And the fact that they didn't pull it off and they waited so long for the first time in a long time, the wait was actually worth it. And good for Zach, good for his family, good for Ben. Ben is done with Batman. At least he now has a high note to close it off with.
Oh, yeah.
And maybe he's not done. Maybe we do get the Deathstroke fucking Arkham origin scene, which would be one of the sickest Batman scenes of all time. I'm going to give it an 8, though. I'm sitting at an 8, and I think it's up there with Man of Steel and BVS. I think Zach has found his footing. I think he delivered what people thought he couldn't deliver, which is, besides the point, but he delivered the movie that a lot of people were like, can he do it? He did it. And for whatever reason, hate him or love him, he gets the comics. And that's all you could ask from a director. At least from my point of view. That's all you could ask of somebody that understands it and at least is willing to do something different. Because we've seen it all. As comic book fans, dude, me and you, boy, my first comic book movie was X-Men. So it's
I think. I mean, yeah, it would have had to be for me too.
Yeah. So we've been through the...
No fucking idea what else could have been. No, yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. We've seen them all.
Yeah.
It feels good to see somebody that's willing to go the extra mile to be this, and that. Even if it's too much, watch it. Don't watch it. Watch it in parts or watch it all. And it worked. So in my point of view, it was probably one of the first highly anticipated movies where we were there's a cut and it worked.
Yeah, pretty much. If I got to give it a rating, even in a bad way, I think I would probably absolutely not in a bad way. Solid 7, 7 out of 10.
Yeah, that's
it's still there because I mean that's not in a bad way. That's just me saying I really enjoyed the film. It's definitely worth another watch. You know what I mean?
Could have been shorter. Yeah, it could have been shorter.
Sure. Yeah, sure. I think they could have definitely done that, and I think all the footage that was in this film, if you had to cut it down to a 2.5-hour movie, I think it could be done.
Yeah.
And I think it could have been still, you would see it and be like, this is a good film. You know what I mean? And that's kind of hard to say and maybe bold, but I'm like, I have a hard time not thinking that I wouldn't enjoy the same film if it was shorter. You know what I mean? If this was the same exact film and you just cut out certain scenes and you never knew those scenes existed, I think you still would be like, that was good. That was a good movie, you know? Mm-hmm. Now, like we said, we just play the waiting game and see what they say and what happens from it. But
it'll be interesting. I think for a company like Warner Brothers to be like, it's over with. It's like, I don't think it is, man. I think if you're a Zack Snyder fan, if you're a fan of these characters, especially Ben Affleck and Henry Cavill Superman, I think the door is definitely open now. More than anything, I think it's more open now than it was 4 years ago. This was never supposed to come out, man. Kind of thankfully, the fucking streaming wars between Netflix, Disney Plus, and HBO but now we're here. And I think if you're going to keep running HBO Max, why would you pass on the opportunity to have more subscribers, more viewers? It's just this movie, from everything I've heard so far, and we'll find out more tomorrow, it broke a shit ton of records. And props to Zach, man. I'm definitely going to check out that new zombie movie that's coming out that takes place in Vegas. It's coming on Netflix.
With our boy Dave Bautista in it.
Who's not going to be in the Hall of Fame this year, which is fucking bullshit, man.
I'm wondering what they're going to say.
No, they already said that they wanted fans to be more present for Dave's, like,
retirement. Oh,
another big thing also for the wrestling fans, Andrade Sin Almas, I still call him that. Official released, man. Official released.
Good for him. Yeah. Good for him. I think he will succeed anywhere he shows up.
Tommy Ann's got to be next. That's my biggest thing. Like,
if fucking I hope so, man.
And hopefully someday fucking Keith Lee, because they're already not using them.
And Ricochet and Ali. And
let's go down the list. Andrade, though, go to AEW, man. Make him the new LAX, you, Pentagon, Phoenix, Santana Ortiz, brings Zelina.
Something, yeah. I mean, yeah. LAX or his own LIJ or
whatever Mexican stable he wants to build.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, or fucking have all the Latinos face each other. I don't give a fuck. That'd be cool as well. Anyways, guys, that is our Zack Snyder highly anticipated review of a movie that took a long time to come out. As Ross said, he gives it a 7. I give it an 8 because I'm biased. It's biased shit, dude. They did, dude. Well, Zack did. Warner Brothers, get your shit together, man. There's literally a world where you guys saw this movie already and you were like, you know what we need? We need Bruce to fuck Lois. No, ladies and gentlemen, this has been another episode of Hollywood Uncensored. Let us know down below in the description, what is your review for the Zack Snyder cut? I think at this point, I don't think I'll ever watch Whedon's cut.
Maybe if I'm like really, really fucked up.
It would have to be on TV. I don't think I would ever watch it. Other than that, it would
the only thing that could have saved Whedon's Justice League is if they had Seal kissed by a rose playing for whatever reason. I think that could have saved it. Now looking back, that's it, though.
And the funny part is there was a cut of that movie that's totally
different. With that, oh, that's fucking awesome. I'm gonna go look that up after.
It is, dude. Fucking Matt Kilmer, like, spoiled it. It's like there's a different cut where, like, we go more into the mind of like Val Kilmer's Batman because of Riddler, and I'm like, release that.
The whole time it's just playing on a fucking loop.
I think you said there's like a version of that movie that has that song for longer too.
That's amazing.
That's the next cut we get out.
Yes, it is.
We will see, ladies and gentlemen. We will see what is next. I would not be surprised though if we see more of the Zack Snyder universe. At least from the aspect of that blog. But let us know down below in the description. It is your boy Hollywood Hogan once again, joined by the good brother Rossi Montgomery.
This guy right here. Always happy to be here. Always fun times. And yeah, always check back with us to. I guess the next movie that we're really, really interested in would probably be Mortal Kombat coming out. So we'll definitely probably talk about that. I mean, we're definitely gonna watch Kong and Godzilla.
Only because I don't think I'm going to go to theaters for that shit. I'll probably go for theaters for Mortal Kombat. I'll watch it at home.
Exactly. So I'm like, we'll definitely review some other stuff, and maybe we'll get back to wrestling in the next like week or so. But
hell yeah, dude. You want to see Hulk Hogan host wrestling?
Oh, holy shit. Yeah, we'll definitely be talking about that. You want to see that
fucking orange steroid fuck be host of that shit? Being like,
it's going to get interesting.
Here's my black friend, Titus.
And he'll say it like that. He'll
this
fucking.
Is brother, this is my brother.
Like, you can't even say that. Oh my god, this is gonna be an interesting mania. All right, guys.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will see you for WrestleMania or some point down the road. I know we got King Godzilla, but like you said, honestly, when it comes to comparisons, I'm all in for Mortal Kombat, even without Johnny Cage. Ladies and gentlemen,
yeah,
this has been episode number, I don't know, the Snyder Cut. We'll see
you guys. There we go.